of the Lord. Keep walking with the Lord all the way. Keep trusting in His word every day. Keep looking for the sun. Watch and pray. Keep walking, trusting all the way. Looking, watching, praying every day. Jesus is our Savior, God and King. We can look to Him for everything. After all He's done, let's shout and sing. Walking in the goodness of the Lord. Keep walking with the Lord all the way. Keep trusting in His word every day. Keep looking for the sun. Watch and pray. Keep walking, trusting all the way. Looking, watching, praying every day.
Thank you. to give us lesser things? What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise?
We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness. We doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while you hear each desperate plea, long that we'd have faith to believe. What if your blessings come through?
Morning. Let's pray together. God, we are here to worship you again this morning and to exalt your only and eternally begotten Son and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And God, how we thrill to see Christ in the Old Testament scriptures, and such is the case again this morning as we open up the pages of your book. Oh God, I pray that you would turn the light on for us. I pray that you would stir our hearts. I pray that you would change us, bring us more into conformity to the image of your Son. We love you, and we desire to demonstrate that love by the way in which we handle your word. We pray this in Jesus' name, amen. Our study in Genesis continues. We are in the process of working our way through a very interesting and even curious narrative in Genesis chapter 21, verses 9 through 21. If you've been with us, you know that we have covered quite a bit of turf here. In verse 9, Sarah sees Ishmael mocking. In verse 10, she tells Abraham to send him and his mom off. In verse 12, God tells Abraham to hearken unto Sarah's voice. And in verse 14, off Hagar and Ishmael go. I'd like to pick up the narrative this morning by reading, starting with verse 15. So take a look. I'm going to be reading verses 15 through 21. Again, Genesis chapter 21, verses 15 through 21. And the water was spent in the skin, and she cast the child under one of the shrubs. And she went and sat down apart from him a good way off, as it were a bowshot. And she said, let me not see the death of the child. And she sat apart from him and lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the lad. And the angel of God called to Hagar out of heaven and said unto her, what ails thee, Hagar? Fear not, for God hath heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad, and hold him in thine hand, for I will make him a great nation. And God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. And she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad drink. And God was with the lad, and he grew and dwelt in the wilderness and became an archer. And he dwelt in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother took him a wife out of the land of Egypt. As Ishmael is about to die, he and his mom meet up with the angel of God. I'm pausing to recognize with you a wonderful truth. We've seen it over and over and over again. This is the seeking and saving God. This is the seeking and saving God who meets us exactly where we are. And this is, once again, setting forth the stark contrast between true biblical Christianity and any and all of man's religions. With true biblical Christianity, you know this well, we revel in it. With true biblical Christianity, God comes to us. He's the one seeking. He's the one saving. With religion, prideful men futilely seek God. Yea, seek to be God. There's an interesting nuance here. It revolves around the title, The Angel of God, in verse 17. Take a look as I read. And God heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of God called to Hagar out of heaven and said unto her, what ails thee, Hagar? Fear not, for God hath heard the voice of the lad where he is. Although we can't be dogmatic about this, we have reason to believe that this angel is actually the angel of the Lord, who is none other than the pre-incarnate Christ. Remember, we've already seen Christ engaged in the unfolding narrative of Abraham, and we can even fine-tune that. We've already seen Christ engaged in the unfolding narrative regarding Hagar and Ishmael. Again, Christ in the Old Testament. So exciting. Turn with me, if you would, back to chapter 16, Genesis chapter 16, as you're heading back there, turning just a few pages. I remind you that barren Sarah gives the Egyptian handmaid Hagar to Abraham. Abraham subsequently goes in unto Hagar, and she conceives. Hagar then begins to despise, view as very little, Sarah. And Sarah, in turn, deals harshly with Hagar. And Hagar, as you recall, flees into the wilderness where she meets up with the angel of the Lord. Take a look at verse 7. Genesis 16 and verse 7. And the angel of the Lord found her by a fountain of water in the wilderness, by the fountain in the way to Shur. Now drop down to verse 10. And the angel of the Lord said unto her, I will multiply thy seed exceedingly, that it shall not be numbered for multitude. You recall we observed, and it's a simple observation, but vital. This is no ordinary angel, for he says, I will multiply thy seed. Again, with excitement, we observe that this is actually God broadly and Christ narrowly. This is the pre-incarnate Christ. This is the one of whom the prophet Micah will later say, his goings forth have been from of old, yea, from everlasting. Please know this about the one and only Savior. He is eternal. I would say to you that if your Savior is not eternal, you are in trouble. We need nothing less than an eternal Savior. And again, he must be God. And that's what we are seeing here. So we see the angel of the Lord in Genesis 16. We see him again in Genesis 18 as he converses with Abraham. And now Hagar is once again about to meet up with him. Take a look at verse 17. I'm referring again to Genesis 21. And God heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of God called to Hagar out of heaven and said unto her, what ails thee, Hagar? Fear not, for God hath heard the voice of the lad where he is. Like with the angel of the Lord back in Genesis chapter 16, the angel of God here is clearly no ordinary angel, for the very next verse, verse 18 says, arise, lift up the lad, and hold him in thine hand, for I will make him a great nation. This is the angel of the Lord. This is God temporarily in flesh. This is the Son of God, the pre-incarnate Christ. This is the second personage of the triune Godhead. Again, Christ in the Old Testament scripture. But there's an interesting and communicative nuance here. The divine being, referred to as the angel of the Lord in Genesis 16, is here in Genesis 21, referred to as the angel of God. Genesis 16, the angel of the Lord. Genesis 21, the angel of God. So although I believe that they are one and the same person, namely the pre-incarnate Christ, the point is that we have two different titles for Christ. Again, back in Genesis 16, when he engages Hagar, he is referred to as the angel of the Lord. And here in Genesis 21, when he engages Hagar, he is referred to as the angel of God. Why the change? What is the distinction? One person, one God. Many names. One person, one and the same person, but two different titles, the angel of the Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, Genesis 16. which is the primary name for God, Jehovah, Yahweh. And here, in Genesis 21, the angel of God, a different primary name for God, Elohim. Again, why the change? Well, Dr. Henry Morrison, his commentary offers an astute observation. Listen very carefully. It is more than coincidental that in Genesis 16 and verse 7, this divine being is called, quote, the angel of Jehovah. Here, Genesis 21, he is called the angel of Elohim. The reason for the change is that Jehovah is God's covenant name. And Hagar was, in the first instance, still under the roof and protection of Abraham. Now, however, she has become a stranger to the covenant of promise, and therefore the name of God, which is used in the name associated with creation and power, rather than redemption. God, Morris goes on to say, is the God of all men, however, whether or not they are embraced in his particular covenant with Abraham, and he has and was graciously concerned with Ishmael and his mother. The name Lord, one of God's primary names, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, Yahweh, Jehovah, is God's covenantal name with Israel. Now listen, I want to pursue that with you for just a moment, but I need to make a short disclaimer. We have one God, many names, one God with many names, one God sporting many titles. And there's a clear sense in which we really can't separate one from the other. It's almost like trying to separate the various characteristics that God holds in perfection. I want you to know I know that. And I could be here this morning and preach with legitimacy a passionate message on the broadness of the primary name Jehovah, Yahweh, and how it's very much applicable to us. And yet, by way of distinction, when you compare the one primary name of God, Jehovah, with the other primary name of God, Elohim, there is a clear distinction which prompts the student to recognize that lying at the heart of the name of Jehovah, this isn't all that's there, but lying at the heart of the name of Jehovah, it is God's forever eternal relationship with the nation of Israel. Again, Jehovah is God's covenantal name with Israel. You recall, it is so sacred to the Jew that he refuses both to write it and to speak it. Jehovah, this is the true God, the one true God who is forever linked to Israel. And doesn't that plug in? We've been noting, especially of late, and yet we see it at every turn in Scripture, and so we don't go long before we're re-emphasizing the fact that God is not done with Israel, the fact that God has pledged to never be done with Israel in a very unique way, in a very peculiar way, his chosen people. And of course, we've been wading through with joy the Abrahamic covenant, where at every turn we are reminded of the foreverness of God's relationship with the nation of Israel. it's prompted me in the past to say things like this: if you can destroy the Israel of God, then in turn you can destroy the God of Israel. But listen, God is not going anywhere. And I remind you that he's the one true God. There are actually no other gods. God isn't going anywhere, nor is Israel. Because Jehovah is Israel's God. In contrast to that, and I'm saying this to you with joy, and again, I am recognizing that we need to be careful about separating the names of God in this way. But here in Genesis 21, we have not the angel of the Lord, but the angel of God, with a view to the Hebrew, the angel of Elohim. Who is that? Well, you know, he is the great creator God, the God of the universe. This is the Genesis 1:1 God. In the beginning, God, Elohim, created the heavens and the earth. Listen, this is the God of the nations. Fortunately for us, he is not, that is God, he is not just the God of Israel. And he is not just the God of the Jews. But he is the God of the nations. He is the God of the Gentiles. Yea, he is the God of all. Any and all people groups. And he can be your God. One God, many names. Think of it, the God of Abraham. Wouldn't that be something? If you and I were Abraham, listen to the title, the God of Abraham. But wonder of wonders, it's not just the God of Abraham, it is also the God of Hagar. And the God of you and me. The God of Thomas William Teal. Wow. Do I like the sound of that? Oh, to first know God, I'm pleading with you again this morning. Listen, the Spirit of God has been tugging on your heart perhaps many times. You've been, and it's hard for you to explain, you've been drawn. God has, at different junctures in your life, actually turned the light on for you. We often refer to the wooing of God, and you have been the recipient of that time after time after time. Pleading with you again this morning. Make him yours. He can be your God. He must be your God. Oh, to know him and then to obey and love and serve him. The God of Abraham, the God of Hagar, the God of you. Let's pray. God, we are so thankful for the first book of the Bible. So thankful for the way in which it systematically reveals you. So thankful for your many names. So thankful for your many titles. So thankful for the significant truth that is inherent in each one. So thankful that we can see through the pages of your word, your personal relationship with various personal people. So glad to know that you are the God of Abraham. So glad to be certain of your forever relationship with Israel, with the Jew. But we're also so glad that you are the God of Hagar, the God of the nations, the God of all of the various people groups. And the best thing of all, so glad that you are our God. Mine. I pray that this is the personal testimony of each and every one who is listening this morning. And if not, that they would come to know you personally, come to have you personally. Through the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, if they need our help, I pray that you would put it in their hearts to contact us. We would be thrilled. So here it is. We often arrive at this place. The import of knowing God and then loving, serving, and obeying Him. May we be marked by that, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.